I start? There's nobody here. I don't know why, but it's 4 o'clock, so I will start anyway.
Okay.
So we have a theorem. Suppose that x and y are compact. Then the product x cross y is compact. So the proof, we start with an open covering, which is called U. No, A, doesn't matter. So let A is, be an open covering. Of x cross y, and so we have to find the finite subcovering. So for every x in x, the slice x small x times y is this is homeomorphic to y. So it's a homeomorphism. It's compact. So it's compact. Y is compact. X and Y are compact. It's compact. The slice is compact. So it's covered. We have an open cover. So A is an open covering of. So A is an open covering, obviously. Of the slice. In x cross y, in the whole space. So the slice is compact, so this means finitely many. We have a finite subcovering. So there's a finite subcovering. Let's say A1AM. Covering the slice, okay? So the slice is, the slice times Y is contained in the union. So then N, so we take the union A1, union AM, is a neighborhood of X cross Y, is an open neighborhood, is a neighborhood of X cross Y so we have a neighborhood of the slice. Sorry, of x, it's neighborhood of small x of the slice. X cross y. So the tube lemma. What does it say? So the tube lemma implies there's a neighborhood W. And it depends x. So x is the index. X is the point. There's a neighborhood wx of x in y, obviously, in x, sorry, such that wx times y is contained in n, in this n. This also depends on x, so I might write nx, but I didn't write here the x, okay? It's contained in n. That's the tube lemma, which we proved yesterday. That's a neighborhood, and so we have the tube lemma. And now we have an open covering of x. Then Wx, x in x, is an open covering of x. But now also x is compact. So x compact, x and y are compact. Here we need x compact. What does it say? There's a finite subcovering. There's a finite subcovering covering, so it's Wx1, W, whatever. What is used here doesn't matter. There's an open covering so far in many. Wx something, xm. M we used before, but it's. So it's a finite subcovering of x. So x is the union, Wx1, union, union, Wxm. Then x cross y is equal to Wx1, so times y is this, so times y, union, union, Wxm, times y, equal to this. So each of these, by construction, each of these is one of these, okay? So it's contained in the union of finitely many elements of A. Each of these, by construction, each of these, so of these, okay, so I cannot write here. Each of these is the union of finitely many elements of A. And then also x cross y is the union of finitely many elements of A cross each of these. So this implies also, then also x cross y is the union of finitely many elements of A. And this means it's compact. So A, X plus Y is compact. We found a finite sum. Maybe it's not the union, but it's contained in the union, I should write, okay? This, it's not completely correct. It's N is a union. Now, what is N? Where's N here? I don't see N. Ah, N is here, yes. N is a union of finitely many. And this is contained in the union, so it's not equal. If this is contained in the union, this is not exactly. Now, each of these is contained in the union of finitely many elements of A. And then also, then X cross Y is the union of, okay? So that's better. Okay, that's a proof. So we prove some other basic results about the theorem, next theorem. So last time we had the small properties, now we prove something, so the theorem. Let X be a simply ordered set. Let X be, so as far as it is simply ordered, always, not partially. Simply ordered set with the order topology. If you write this, it's always the order topology, with the order topology. Okay. So we have a simply ordered set with the order topology. Let X be a simply ordered, simply ordered set with the order topology, having the least upper bound property, with the least upper bound property. So it's not a linear continuum. We have two conditions, but here one, just one condition, with the least upper bound property. We need only the first one, upper bound property. We need only the first one, the more interesting one in some sense. Then each closed interval in X is compact. Okay. Then each closed interval. So we write AB. Closed interval AB in X is compact. So proof. So for connected, we need two conditions, least upper bound property and enough points. Okay, here we need only the least upper bound property. Let A, so always the same, let A be an open covering. You have to prove compact. So in open covering of AB, of this interval. So let's see, be the set of all points Y in AB in this interval such that the interval from A to Y, the interval from A to Y is contained in the union of finitely many elements of A. Okay? It's contained in the union is covered by finitely many elements of A. That's the same, of course. Okay, sometimes it's contained in the union of finitely many elements of A, of our open covering. So what we see is that, of course, A is, then, of course, it's trivial that A is in C. No, just one. It's an open covering. So it's not empty. It's not empty, okay, because there's A. And let now C, small c, how is it called in the book? C, yes. The least upper bound be the least upper bound, or the sup of C. So we consider the least upper bound of this subset, C. So this is smaller or equal to B, no? Clearly. We are in the closed interval, A, B. So C is the lowest upper bound. And we prove two things now. The first thing is that C is in C. So we prove two things. Two facts. Two facts. So the first one is that C is in C. That means AC is covered by finitely many. Okay? So let there is, how is it called? A in A, such that C is contained in one of these. C is in A, which contains C, okay? So we make our usual picture here now. We have A, we have B, and we have C, which is least upper bound of all these points here, C, okay? So C is in A. So we can assume, obviously, that C is bigger than A, and here we don't know, it might be B, okay? But it's bigger than A. If C equal A, we are done, okay? Since if C is equal to A, then of course C is in C now. A is in C, okay? So this is a trivial case. So we can assume that, okay? And now A is open. So what does it mean? A is open and C is in A. So we are in the order topology, so there's an interval. I don't know, on this side, open interval, okay? Because you have larger. On this side, it might be B. So maybe, I don't care about this side, okay? So there's D, so this is a D. A open implies there's D smaller than C, such that the interval D, C, and here closed interval on the right-hand side, I finish here, is contained in A. Now, AD is covered by finitely elements. D is smaller than A. D is smaller than C, sorry. Now, AD is covered by finitely many elements. Is covered by finitely many elements of A. Since D is smaller than C, okay? C is the least upper bound of these which are covered. If you get some, yeah, okay. Since D is smaller than C. So AD is covered by finitely many elements of A, and then also AC. And then also AC. Just add, what do we add? A, just add A, okay? One more. So this means C is in C, okay? So this implies then C is in C. So this is the first point. C is in C. And now the second point is, that C is equal to B. This implies the theorem, okay? So this implies the theorem. That means C is in C, no? So A, B is covered by finitely many. So we have a finite subcovering. So this is okay. Okay, C is equal to B. Suppose C is smaller than B. By contradiction, I suppose. Yes, suppose C is smaller than B. By contradiction, no? By contradiction, suppose C is smaller than. And now we have again our picture, four times. Two times for connected, two times for this one. So here's A, Here's B, and now C is smaller than B. Here on this, on this side, I don't care, okay? It might be equal to A. That would not be so good, of course, but C is smaller than B, suppose. So again, as before, let C be in A, which is an element of our open covering. Okay? Now we are on the other side, on this side. So there's D. So A is open again, same proof, A open. This implies there's D, and now it's bigger than C, such that there's D bigger than C, such that CD, closed C, open at D, is contained in A, because A is open. This is our order topology. It's contained in A. By I, so I will write here, because then we are close to this, and then I go to the other side if I find something for the blackboard. So I will finish the proof here. So CD is in A. No, by the first point, AC is covered by finitely many, no? Well, C is in C, by finitely many elements of A. And then also, what we want? CD, and then also AD. The closed interval AD. AC is okay, but also AD is covered by finitely many. Just at what A? Just at A? No, that's okay, just at A, no? So we have, here we have contained infinitely many, and now AC, and one which contains D. We are not sure about D, okay? Just at A, and maybe, if D is in A, we are done, okay? But we don't know that. And maybe one other element of A containing D. If D is not in A, okay? If D is not in A. But that's a contradiction, no? Because what was C? C was the least upper bound. So contradiction. So I finish here, contradiction. Since D is bigger than C, and AD is covered by finitely many, okay? But C was the least upper bound of all this. So that's the proof. That's the end of the proof. Okay. Now I will go to the other side. I will restart on the other side. So corollary, of course, there's a standard corollary, the standard example corollary. for I, closed real intervals are compact. That is one of the basic points in analysis, okay? Closed intervals in R, closed intervals in the reals are compact. That's the standard, no surprise. Second one, the ordered square is compact. That's not so standard. And closed intervals in the ordered square, okay? The ordered square, so I ordered square, why is this compact? That is a closed interval, no? Which one? 0 times 0, 1 times 1. That's a closed interval, okay? So it's compact. It's also connected, no? By a similar proof, okay? It's connected. There we need a second condition. Okay, here we need only the least upper bound property. It's a linear continuum, no? So proof, the proof of 2i is, the proof is R and I ordered square are linear continuum. Continua. Okay, that we saw, that's an exercise, okay? The ordered square is a linear continuum, that's an exercise. So standard example, non-standard example. You come back to the ordered square still. We have many properties now. It's connected. It's not path connected. It's a linear continuum, so it's also compact. It's first, that was another exercise. It's first countable, but not second countable. So then the question, of course, is it metrizable, no? Okay, it's first countable. So it may be metrizable, but the answer is no. That will be an exercise, okay? One of the most interesting exercises, maybe the most interesting exercise, which I give today, and then next week we discuss this exercise. It's easy. It's like RL, okay? RL is not metrizable. First countable, not metrizable. That is another exercise. By RL, the reason is that we have a countable dense subset, okay? For the closed interval, we don't have that, so we need another proof. Okay, it cannot be the same proof. So what is the next one? The standard theorem. So the next one is, let's say, Heine-Borel, what does it say, theorem? So we prove some basic facts, again, about this Heine-Borel. I don't know. How do you know this? How do you call this? But a subset A of Rn is compact. A subset A of Rn is compact if and only if A is closed and bounded. With respect to the Euclidean metric, okay? if we cut this metric, everything is bounded, okay? So it depends on the metric. It's bounded, of course, with respect to the Euclidean metric. So this is sometimes. The typical theorem, what is compact, okay, in Rn, in analysis, closed and bounded, okay, that's, but that's not our definition, that's far from our definition of compactness, of course. So let's prove that. So proof. So there are two directions, if and only if. One direction is not interesting. Let's start with that. It's so which one? A is compact. So this direction, okay? This is not the interesting direction. Okay. If we know it's compact, that's what we want. Okay? So The other one is the interesting torrential. So A, suppose A is compact. I mean, this is not, suppose A is compact. Then A is closed. This implies A is closed. Why is that? We need Hausdorff here, no? Compact are closed, but in Hausdorff spaces, okay? Since Rn is Hausdorff. Here we need Hausdorff. Yes, we are in Rn, so it's Hausdorff. Otherwise, we have a problem, okay? And now what we need is that bounded, okay? So A is contained, obviously, in the union of the ball, Euclidean matrix 0, with radius n, n in n. So this is all Rn, no? The union of these balls is everything. So this means these balls, what are they? It's an open covering of Rn, okay? Open covering. No. Yes, of Rn, but of A in Rn. Of A in Rn, by open sets in Rn. So now A is compact. That means finitely many suffice. But they are growing, so one suffices, okay? So this means A is contained in one of these, B, D, 0, with some n, n in n. So this means A is bounded, okay? A bounded. So this is not so interesting. That's one direction, not the interesting. The interesting direction is the other one. Here we don't use anything except Hausdorff. Now that's the only interesting point of this proof, that we need Hausdorff here, okay? The rest is definitions. The interesting direction is this one. Because then if we know something is closed and bounded, we want compact. And then we have applications of compact, okay? There are many applications of compact. So this is the interesting direction. And here we have to work. Not now, we already have the theorems, but this is not immediate, okay? So A, suppose A is closed and bounded. Now we suppose that A is closed and bounded. And we want to prove that A is compact. So A bounded, this implies that A is contained in some ball like this, if we want. But it's also contained in some hypercube, okay, large hypercube. So hypercube would mean we have a product, no. So hypercube, interval, minus c, I don't have here, no, constant to the n. In Rn. Well, this is a hypercube. So C is some constant, okay? C bigger than zero, obviously. That's an n-dimensional cube, okay? Because it's bounded. That's bounded, okay? We use bounded here. It's contained in something like this. So, and now, where's the work? So by minus C, C is compact. That we proved, okay, now. That's a real interval. So see, here we have to work a little bit, okay? It's compact. And then we have, of course, that product of compact, finite product, that we proved, okay? So minus c, c to the n is compact. That's another theorem. Finite product of compact spaces, arbitrary products, but that we don't need here, is compact. What is A? A is closed in a compact. A closed in a compact set implies, here we don't need Hausdorff also, okay? Closed in compact means always what? Compact, right? What we want. So that's it already. So it follows from these two theorems here, okay? Real intervals are compact, products of compact are compact. Okay, that's it. So this is Heine Borel. What is next? Another well-known and important result, but almost trivial proof, is a maximum minimum value. So let's see that also from analysis, okay? For connected spaces, it's the intermediate value, okay? And for compact spaces, it's the maximum and minimum value. These are two basic things of analysis. Almost everything depends on one of these, okay, in analysis of Rn. But not only Rn. Okay, so intermediate value theorem. No, not intermediate, theorem. And this is maximum and minimum. Value theorem. Maximum and minimum value theorem. So this says the following. So let f from x to y be continuous. F from x to y be continuous. We have a continuous map. So we have a continuous map where x is compact, x compact, and then we have to compare elements of y, maximum, minimum, and so on. Okay, so y ordered with the order topology. Y ordered with the order topology. Okay, so this is the hypothesis. Continuous map from a compact space to an ordered space is the order topology. So there are points C and D in X such that f of X is between f of C and f of D for every X in X. So this means this is maximum value. This is minimum value. Okay, maximum value. It assumes it's maximum value, and this obviously is a minimum. That's the name: maximum, minimum, minimum, minimum value. Okay. So it assumes it's maximum and. It's not just a, okay. So proof. This proof is very easy, proof. We use only definition. We use almost definition of compactness, nothing else. Let's see. So first of all, A compact. Now what is A? Y A, X. So A, that's in the book. A is equal to F of X. The image of a compact is compact. A is the image, F of X is compact. And why? Because the image of a compact set is compact. Okay? Image of connected is connected, of compact is compact, of path connected, of Hausdorff. Is Hausdorff. So one can think about any property, okay? So it's compact. Suppose, by contradiction, okay, sorry, by contradiction. Suppose that f of x, a equal f of x, so this is f of x, has no largest element, no maximum, okay, has no largest element. Maximum. Suppose, so that's by contradiction, okay. So suppose it's no, then the proof goes like this. Then, so we take minus infinity, A, A in A, so A is the image. So we take all these. This means all elements smaller than A, okay? Minus infinity, between minus infinity and A. We take all these. That's an open covering. Of A, no, yes, of A in where are we? In Y. This is an order topology, okay? It's an open, why is it an open covering? So take any A in A, okay? This does not contain A, okay? This is open here. But A is not the maximum. We don't have a maximum. So there's an element of A which is larger than A. Then A, B, no, A prime. Then A is contained in minus infinity A prime for this larger element, okay? So if we don't have a maximum, then this is an open covering of A in Y, okay? Because for every A, we find something larger, and then we get A. We have all elements of A. Yes. It's an open covering of A in Y. But A is compact, okay? That we said. A compact. What does it mean? We have an open covering, we have a finite subcovering. But this is linearly ordered, simply ordered. So finitely many, but then we take the maximum of these. So this means A is contained in one of these, contained in minus infinity, just one, and A zero. It's contained in just one, okay, A zero in A. And now we get a stupid contradiction because A0 is in A. A0 is in A, okay? But A0 is not here. So A0 is not here. So that's a contradiction. Contradiction. So this is. We didn't use anything here, okay? We just play around with the definition of compactness. So this is, in this sense, is a trivial proof, okay? However, it's an important theory. So where's the crucial point? The crucial point, again, is we have to prove something is compact first. And the work is here, not in this, in the proof of this theorem, okay? The work is proving something is compact. That's very useful. And thereby has to work, okay? And if you know it's compact, then we can apply this. This is just playing around with the definition of compactness, okay? But it's important, conceptually important theorem, like the intermediate. It's similar as the intermediate value, okay? Also, this is quite, almost trivial proof, okay? But there we have to prove that something is connected first, Okay, here we have to prove something is compact. And this is the work. And proving non-compact, non-connected, means that that's in general trivial. Okay, that's easy. Okay, so where are we? So that's the maximum minimum value. So now it's an interesting point. So here we are, no? So now we have discussed two other notions of compactness. Okay, so definition. A topological space is limit point compact. A topological space is limit point compact if every infinite subset has a limit point. So that's the definition of limit point compact. Okay. That seems more reasonable than compact, the definition almost. Okay. So if somebody says compact, yeah, what means compact? We have infinitely many points, then they should accumulate, okay, in a compact set. So this seems to be much closer to the word compact than this strange business with finite subcoverings, okay? But nevertheless, the other one is, we will see, is stronger and easier to handle in general than this one, okay? It's interesting to compare. So a topological, so this is the first. The second is a topological space is limit point compact, X, always X, sorry. X is sequentially compact, so I write immediately sequent. This is even worse, sequentially compact. X is sequentially compact. If every sequence has a convergent subsequence. From analysis, that's also reasonable, okay? If every sequence in X as a convergent subsequence. Okay. So this seems to be also reasonable. This also, for compactness, no? These are notions of compactness, yeah. But we know already that sequences are not always so good, no? If a space is first countable, then maybe sequences are okay. But if it's not first countable, then we have a problem, okay, with sequences. As I said yesterday, then we have to generalize sequences to a non-countable setting. And then there are filters or something like that, okay? Instead of sequences, one can use filters. Then it's okay. But this is a non-countable version of sequence filter, okay? If you stay with sequences, we are in a countable region, and that's not sufficient. So these seem reasonable. More important, limit point compact. Sequences are difficult sometimes, okay? In analysis, of course, Rn, it's okay. We will see that. If it's first countable, well, that's not so clear. If it's metric, then they are, that we prove today. If a metric space, then they're equivalent. Compact, limit point, compact, sequentially compact. That's the same for metric. For Rn, it's the same. So in analysis, you can define this way, it's always the same, okay, compactness. But for other spaces, it's not the same. For more general spaces, it's not the same. And for metric spaces, it's the same. Then you ask, well, maybe first countable, no? That's almost metric, so maybe for first countable. That's interesting. We will see, okay, we will prove, and then we can think what we need, really. Maybe first countable is sufficient. I forgot. we will prove it, and then we'll see. So I will continue here, because there's not the first is so proposition. Okay, so let's continue here. So proposition X compact implies, so this is stronger, X limit point compact. X compact, then X is limit point compact, okay? And then of course, we need an example for the other direction, okay? But that's again difficult. That's for connected and path connected, okay? The examples, one has to work a little bit, and here one has to work a little bit. Now, if you want Hausdorff spaces, we have to work. If you want not Hausdorff spaces, it's very artificial, okay? But for Hausdorff spaces, so proof. Compact implies limit point compact, always proof. So proof. Suppose X is compact, so X is compact. Suppose X is compact, then. And we have to prove limit point compact, okay? So suppose that X is compact, suppose that A is a subset. Of X without limit points, okay? No limit points. What we have to prove, it's finite, right? We will prove that it is finite. So if it's infinite, it must have limit points. Subset of X without limit points. So we take a subset A without limit points. So A is equal to a closure is equal to A union A prime, the limit points, right? So this is equal to A. So A is closed. What about a closed subset of a compact? So then it's compact. We don't need Hausdorff here, okay? I didn't write Hausdorff. So that's why the book doesn't show Hausdorff. Hausdorff, very often you don't need. You just need compactness, okay? Sometimes you need. But for many proofs, you don't need Hausdorff, okay? So he defines compactness without Hausdorff. That's the reason. A is closed, so A is compact. So let A be an A. We take any point. A is not a limit point of it. So A is not a limit point. Then A, it has no limit points. So A is not a limit point. Of A, because it has no limit points. What means not a limit point? Means there's a neighborhood of A which intersects capital A, only in A, in no other point. That's our definition of limit. So there's a neighborhood. Neighborhood. UX. So what's it called? No, A. UA. Of A such that the intersection of UA with this neighborhood, with A, it's only A, no other point. This means it's not a limit point, exactly, okay? So we have only this point. However, then, we take all these UA, A in A. What is this? That's an open covering of A. We have all points. It's an open covering. Of A in X. What is our space? X in X. It's an open covering of A in X. So A is compact. So there's a finite subcovering, okay? So it means A is contained in finitely many of these. So UA1 union UAN. Yes. So finitely many. And that means, of course, that A is contained in A1, AN. Maybe equal. I don't care. Okay? So A is finite. This implies A is finite. So if it's infinite, then it has a limit. So this is a proof, easy proof, okay? It's very easy to work with this condition of compactness, okay? Finite subcovering. It's a very efficient condition, okay, to prove things. Sequences are much more difficult, okay, in general. For exercise. X. Metric and limit point compact implies if a space is a metric space and limit point compact, then it's sequentially compact. Okay, so that's an exercise. So A. X is sequentially compact. But here we have some strong hypothesis, no metric. So I will do this exercise now. Metric space, which is limit point compact. So now the question is, for metric spaces, we will prove then that compact, limit point compact, sequential compact are equivalent, okay? And then I asked you, so what about first countable instead of, okay? So here, a remark. It suffices to assume that X is first countable and Hausdorff we also need. First countable does not imply Hausdorff, but we need both conditions, of course. So metric spaces are first countable and Hausdorff, okay? So it suffices. We will do the proof. It suffices to assume so that X is first countable. And Hausdorff. First countable does not imply Hausdorff, okay? So we need Hausdorff. They are separate. And Hausdorff. And limit point compact, of course. Okay. Instead of metric, metrizable. Okay, let's see the proof of this exercise. I'm doing some exercises. Obviously, those which I think are the most important or the most interesting. No? So proof. Not have a proof, sequentially compact. So we take a sequence, okay? Let a sequence, so xn be a sequence in our space is x. So we take any sequence. We have to find a convergent subsequence, okay? There are two cases. We have to consider two cases. The first is, we take A, which is xn, n in n. So we take the set associated with the sequence, okay? The first case is this is finite. This may be finite. Suppose that this is finite. Then we have a constant subsequence, obviously, okay? Then there's a constant subsequence. We have only finitely many elements. Then there is a constant. A constant, and hence convergent subsequence, okay? And hence convergent subsequence. So this is easy. This is a trivial case, okay, if it's constant. Then the second is, suppose that A is infinite, okay? Second, suppose that A is infinite.
No, A
is infinite. But what is A? X is, so A is a limit point, okay? So this implies A is a limit point. So infinite, and here is finite. Infinite, we need infinite for limit point. It has a limit point. X zero in X. And now we want to have a we have to construct a convergent subsequence. Okay, so that is easy also, but by induction or recursive definition. Okay, so we consider. So now what have we have a metric space. So A. So A intersection, so X0, so I have BD, we have a metric space, X0 with radius 1, intersection A. X0 is a limit point, so this is non-empty, okay? Because X0 is a limit point of A, okay? Maybe there's A. If it's A, there's also another point, but at this point, it doesn't matter. So let, so there's A n1. How is the sequence? What is the sequence? X, xn, no? Where did I write it? Xn is the sequence, yes. So xn1. So we choose a point, xn1, okay, in this intersection. That's our first. So then we take bd, x1, 1 half, x0, so, okay, 1 half, intersection A. It's not empty, but that's now not sufficient. So we find the second point, okay? But maybe we find the same, maybe we find something smaller, x, x1, okay, or x2. So we're jumping. We have, in a subsequence, we have to go, okay? We have to n1, xn2, and 2 has to be bigger than n1, not smaller, okay? This is non-empty. That's not sufficient now. But this is infinite, since x is Hausdorff. Infinite. It's a limit point of A. And if it's a Hausdorff, infinite since X is Hausdorff. So in a Hausdorff, that we did. In a Hausdorff space, the intersection is always infinite. If you have a limit point, then it intersects in infinitely many points, okay? So that is important, infinite. So x n2 I want here, but n2 bigger than 1, so we can choose. N2 bigger than n1, okay? And then it's okay. Then we get BD, so x0, 1 over 3, so we go on. Intersection A is infinite again. Infinite, so x and 3. We take here, no? And n3 bigger than n2, no? N3 bigger than n2. So recursively, we construct a subsequence now. That's important. Where is it? Here, n1, n2 bigger than n1, n3 bigger than n2, and so on. Okay. So we have a subsequence. That's a subsequence. So we get a subsequence. Xni of the sequence Xi, of the sequence Xi. Xn. So we get a subsequence, okay? And now this converges to X0, okay? With, and that's what we want. So Xni converges to x0 if I goes to infinity. I equal 1, 2, 3, okay? Then it converges to x0. Why? Well, what means convergent? Means any neighborhood of x0 should contain all of these, except for finitely many at the beginning. And that's okay, because I lost concentration now. X0. So we take a neighborhood of X0. We take a neighborhood, epsilon neighborhood of X0. Yes, okay. Of course, all these points are in these balls here, right? In these balls, okay? And if n is large now, if n is large, then this ball is contained in the ball around x0 with radius epsilon for some given epsilon, okay? If n is large. And then we have all points. So this is contained in some BD x0 epsilon, and then we have 1 over n smaller than epsilon, then we have all points, okay? So this is. So now you see, it is sufficient to assume what we need is Hausdorff. Hausdorff we need, okay? Otherwise, we get stuck. We are stuck in this point. Hausdorff we need. But first contour is okay. First contour is sufficient. Why? Then we don't take, if f, so remark. If x is only first countable, and Hausdorff. Hausdorff we need, okay? And Hausdorff, of course. Hausdorff we need at this point, and Hausdorff. Metric spaces are Hausdorff. So then we don't have to write it. But first countable spaces need not be Hausdorff, so we have to add it. X is only, if X is only countable, replace BD X0 1 over N by UN for a fundamental family of neighborhoods for a fundamental. For a fundamental family or collection of neighborhoods, U1 containing U2, containing U3, and so on, of X0. Meaning that every neighborhood contains one, and then all the others, okay, meaning that, so every neighborhood. That's first countable. So every neighborhood of X0 contains UN, contains all UN for large N. So the proof is the same, okay? So here we need only first countable and Hausdorff. So it's an exercise for first countable, okay? There's no difference between here. You need Hausdorff, first countable, that's it. So theorem. Say again and louder. The C, if it converges, it's unique, yes. The limit point of the sequence is unique, yes. I don't understand the question exactly. We have to, we want to, a convergent subsequence we need, okay? So I say that this subsequence converges to X0, okay? No, it's true because any neighborhood, so if U is a neighborhood of X0, okay? Then, of course, this let BD X0 epsilon be contained in U, okay? We have a metric space. So we are back in the metric, okay? I don't understand you very well, because there's this. What didn't we say?
We didn't say that Xn converges.
Xn doesn't converge. Xni converges to this X0. No, A has a unique limit point. I don't know. A is an infinite subset, and I don't know if this is a unique limit point. No. Hausdorff means if you have a convergence, then the point of convergence is unique. But a unique limit point, I don't know. That's not clear. Why should it be unique? A has a unique limit point, an infinite subset. There might be the situation where we have infinite subset and we have, in some sense, two sequences, no? A mixture of two sequences. One converges to one point, one to the other point. And so we have the sequence x1, x3, x5, x7, which converges to one point. And x2, x4, x6, x8 converges to another point, okay? It's not unique. I don't know. There's no uniqueness. But the proof is okay or not. You make it too complicated. No, no. A not does not have a unique limit point. That's not true. Okay? We construct a convergent subsequence, okay? But maybe there's another convergent subsequence converging to another limit point. In fact, if this, where's A? I have, it's difficult now with A is this, okay? So, A is infinite, okay? It may have two limit points. For one limit point, this construction gives a subsequence. For the other limit point, it gives another subsequence. It has three limit points. Then we get three subsequences, which converge to different points. Now, there's no uniqueness here, okay? You just take one limit point, x0, and then we construct a convergent subsequence. If you take another limit point, x1, x1 is not good, x1 is one, x0 prime, then you again construct a subsequence, okay? But it's a different subsequence, completely different. And you have a third limit point of A, then you may, it may have infinitely, I suppose it may have infinitely many limit points A, okay? So you get infinitely many subsequences.
Maybe sinus n.
What?
Sinus n have infinite point, infinite limit points. Sinus n.
Sine? What is sinus n?
Yes, sinus n.
Yes.
Minus one, all of points in the segment, yeah.
So,
the limit
yeah.
point.
So there's no uniqueness at all, okay? You say A has a unique limit point, that's not true. An infinite subset may have many limit points, okay? And the sequence may have many convergent subsequences converging all to different points, okay? Okay? A is an infinite subset which may have infinitely many limit points, okay? For each limit point, you make this construction. And you get different sequences convergent, obviously. Because the same sequence, if it's convergent, if it's Hausdorff, then the limit is unique. Okay? That's true. So for another limit point of A, you get another sequence. It cannot be the same. Because that's true. In the Hausdorff space, if you have a convergent sequence, then the limit is unique. Yeah, true. Okay? So that means if you take another limit point here, you get a different sequence. Okay? Okay? Good. So where are we? So theorem. Sorry. Theorem. So let X be metrizable, metric, metrizable, the same. Then the following are equivalent. That I said already. So first is A is compact. So here is metrizable. A is compact. The second is A is limit point compact. And the third is A is sequentially compact. So for metric space, all the same. Okay, so that's the theorem. For metric spaces, we have compact, equivalent to limit point compact, equivalent to sequentially compact. Okay, so here it's the same. In analysis, Rn, it's the same. Okay? You can use this definition or that definition, or Heine-Borel, Rn, okay? So we have many, many versions of many possible definitions of compactness. But in general, no. So what is an interesting point? Not too interesting. I mean, here we have, so the proof, of course, we have already three directions, okay? I'm getting, I have 10 minutes. So proof. So I implies 2i. Compact implies limit point compact. Also, in general, we don't need in general. No, this is, we proved already, in holds in general. We don't need metrizable here, okay? Without metrizability. Well, something like that. Also in general, without, so we don't need this here. 2i implies 3i. That's exactly our exercise, right? Exercise. The exercise. And here we don't need metrizable, no? We need first countable and so the question is maybe this is true for first countable and Hausdorff. I think it's not true, but this get questions which are maybe complicated. I forgot that. I didn't think about it, okay? Here's metrizable. But for this direction, we need only it's not so it seems to be quite close to metrizable, no? First countable. And Hausdorff. Metric spaces are first countable and Hausdorff, yes. But this is more general. Okay. And so we have to prove, remains to prove, or it remains to prove that 3i implies i. Okay, that we have to prove. And here's the basic, there's a back number lemma. So I will write this now. That's the main point here. So I will write the Lebesgue number lemma. Well, if I find it. There it is. So theorem. And that's the Lebesgue number lemma. So I write the standard version now first, okay? That means let A be an open covering of the compact metric space X, always X. So we have a compact metric space, which is not so good for the proof, because here we have not compact. We have, what do we have? We sequentially compact. So that's not the version we need exactly. But that's a standard version, compact metric space. Then there exists, let A be an open covering. Then there exists, delta bigger than zero. So this is called a Lebesgue number. Uh, Lebesgue number associated to the open covering A, okay? Associated to the open covering A. That's a, called the Lebesgue number. That's a Lebesgue number. Associated, there exists delta such that every subset of X with a diameter smaller than delta, with a diameter smaller than delta, smaller than delta, less than delta, smaller than delta, so if you have a small subset, the diameter is smaller than delta, is contained in at least one A in A, okay? It's contained. If it's small, then it's contained in one of these. It's contained in at least one A in A. What means diameter? What is diameter? How is it defined, diameter? So you take any two points and the distance, and you take the least upper bound, which might be infinite, okay? The diameter may be infinite of also, okay? It might be infinite. But it's the least upper bound over the distances between pairs of points, okay? For a disk, circle, it's the diameter, okay? The usual diameter. Twice the radius, okay? Yes. But that's not good for this, because we don't have compact here. We have sequentially compact. So we prove the, so proof, we prove under the, that's the standard version, okay? The good version, or the standard version. But we need a little bit stronger version, so we prove under the weaker hypothesis the proof. We prove the theorem under the weaker hypothesis. Well, under the weaker hypothesis, under the hypothesis, it's weaker, yes, but we have to think of it. Under the hypothesis that X is sequentially compact instead of compact, that X is sequentially compact. Instead of compact. Then we can, well, it's sequentially compact. So this is compact metric. If it's compact, it's, let me say, if it's compact, okay, here in this theorem, it's compact metric. So compact implies limit point compact. Limit point compact metric implies sequentially compact. That we know already, okay? So sequentially compact is okay. So this is, we don't know the other way around, okay? So we prove it under the hypothesis is sequentially compact, okay? So now, we have 5:30. So, I mean, I will, so next week I will start with the proof of the Lebesgue number lemma. under this hypothesis, okay, and then we have to prove. This is easy, okay? And the Lebesgue number. So next Monday, I prove this under this hypothesis, and then application of this. Okay. Or exercises. Page 170, exercise 7, together with exercise 4 on page 92. That's a very easy exercise, but it's similar. I mean, no, it's not similar. This is open map, closed map. So together with. So first you do this one, together with exercise 4 on page, what is it, 92. This is very easy. That's one of the first exercises, which I didn't give. Did I give it? Well, page 92. No, I didn't give it, OK? But this is a very easy exercise, OK? So you do this first, and then you do this. This is open map. And here, closed map, okay? This is for compact spaces. So 7 and 9. Page 170, exercise 9. This is a generalization of the tube lemma, okay? Actually, both. This uses the tube lemma. This is a generalization of the tube lemma. These are exercises for compact spaces. Page 181, exercise 4. And finally, my favorite, the most interesting exercises of all, maybe, in the book, which we see, not in the book, is page 94, which is 4 again. And this is the exercise which implies that the order square is not metrizable, OK? That is this exercise. So this implies the ordered square is not metrizable. So this is a very interesting exercise, OK? It's not very difficult, OK? And also in another context of metrization, this has a certain, OK? Metrizable spaces, compact metrizable spaces, and this exercise is one direction. So these are the exercises, the last group of exercises. I will do this maybe probably next Monday, okay? This exercise here. Next Monday, okay? It's similar to the proof that RL is not metrizable. Similar. But we use another property here, okay? But it's analogous, not similar, analogous, okay?
Professor?
What?
Idea for this exercise is metric compact space is separable, yes?
What means separable? Countable dense subset?
Yes, yes. This compact metric space is separable.
No, no. So this ordered square is not separable.
So it is not metrizable.
It's not separable. Yes. It has no. What means separable? Separable means a countable dense subset.
No, we solve this exercise by using contradiction principle. We suppose order square is metric space, then compact metric space is separable. This is contradiction. compact metric space is separable.
A compact metric space is separable, yeah. But that one has to prove.
Yes.
That. Yes, okay. Compact metric space is separable, yes.
This contradiction for our imagination, our suppose.
Let's talk Monday about this, next Monday, okay? So we discuss this, I don't want to discuss it now, okay?
Okay, okay.
So this is the most interesting exercise, and I will talk about this. We discuss this next Monday. Then we can discuss about separable, we didn't define. Now separable means the definition would be countable dense subset, no? That's sometimes called separable, okay? But not in the book. He comments, he doesn't like the word separable, okay? Because this is used for other. So we see next Monday and discuss this, okay? Who is talking here?
Mir Mohsin.
This one?
Yes. Mir Mohsin, yes.
That's a difficult name. You are from what country?
Uzbekistan.
Which one?
Uzbekistan.
Yeah, that's easy to remember. The name is more difficult to
yes,
remember.
Yes, I know.
Okay, so we see next Monday, okay? And this is the last group of exercises. And next week is the last week. So I'm somewhat under pressure to finish. Next week, we have normal spaces, okay? Okay, so I close this now. Bye-bye to the other one. So I close the microphone.